Hello friends, I am Dr. Anjum Rashid. Today I will discuss glucose 6 phosphate dehydrogenase deficiency in children. This video consists of two sections. In the first section, I will discuss the drugs and foods to be avoided and foods which are allowed in G6PD deficiency. Then in the second section, I will discuss the etiology, pathogenesis, symptoms, diagnosis and treatment of G6PD deficiency. Here is a list of drugs which should be avoided in G6PD deficiency. These are the antibiotics, then are the antimalarials and other drugs like doxorubicin and raspericase. Then included are the analgesics, vitamin K, ascorbic acid and dimercaprol, certain antihistamine and other drugs. Now, diabetic ketoacidosis, hepatitis and sepsis can also trigger hemolysis in G6PD deficiency. Now friends, I will give you the name and pictures of foods which should be avoided in G6PD deficiency. These include fava beans, legumes, pods in general, menthol, artificial colors, especially blue color, corn syrup, soya milk, soy chunks and products, low-fat cheese and cottage cheese, refined sugar, chini, processed fruit jams, gluten-free products with guar gum, artificial ascorbic acid, red wine, coke, fast foods, high dose of vitamin K, bitter gourd, eggplant, canned fruit juices, Chinese herb and Chinese food, peanut and peanut butter, black tea extract, green tea extract, waxed fruits and vegetables, fenugreek or methi, tonic water, dried fruit except plum and dark raisin, processed fruits and vegetables, quinine, mothballs, henna, chemical or gaseous sterilization of surgical instrument, deep food containers to refrigerate, canned soups, tomato ketchup, vinegar, hot dogs, processed meat, canned fish, candies, noodles, dehydrated potatoes, crackers, baked item, cakes and cookies, blueberries, honeysuckle flower herb, chimonthus flower, figwort flower, Eclavia indica. Now here are the names and pictures of foods which are allowed in G6PD deficiency. Natural yogurt, natural vitamin C, natural vitamin K, pomegranate, ginger and garlic, plum, apricot, apples, pear, cucumber, pearl millet, proso millet, kodra, sorghum millet, little millet, finger millet, foxtail millet, amaranth, buckwheat, barnyard millet, kiwi, Brussels sprouts, beetroot, nuts except peanuts, avocado, broccoli, parsley, dates, oranges, artichokes, corn, sunflower seed and oil, wheat, rice, natural vegetable oils and animal oil, black pepper, peppers, oats, carrots, spinach, strawberries, kale, barley, tomatoes, unprocessed meat, home-cooked fresh fish, homemade sweets, homemade jams, homemade pickle, homemade ice creams, homemade tomato sauce, shallow containers, properly wash fruits and vegetables, always peel them, autoclave for surgical instrument. G6PD deficiency is a hereditary condition which results from a structural defect in glucose-6-phosphate dehydrogenase enzyme. This is a housekeeping enzyme and is particularly important for the survival of red blood cells and their ability to respond to oxidative stress. Now, it is the most common red cell enzyme deficiency in human and affect about 400 million people worldwide. Now, there is a high prevalence in persons with African, Asian and Mediterranean descent. Now, friends, I will discuss its etiology. G6PD is an important enzyme of hexo-monophosphate shunt. Approximately 10% of glucose taken by the RBC passes through this pathway to provide reduced nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide phosphate, which is also called NADPH. And this NADPH is necessary for the conversion of oxidized glutathione to reduced glutathione. Now, reduced glutathione is essential for the physiological inactivation of oxidant compounds such as hydrogen peroxide that are generated within the RBC. And it is also helpful to inactivate other externally introduced oxidant agents such as certain drugs, infections, and fava beans. Gene that code for G6PD is located in the distal long arm of the X chromosome at the XQ28 locus. Currently, 186 mutations in the G6PD gene have been documented, and most are single base changes that result in an amino acid substitution. In most instances, the deficiency is due to enzyme instability, thus older red blood cells are more deficient than the younger ones. Now, G6PD is inherited as an X-linked recessive disorder, so male usually manifests the abnormality and female are the carriers. Now, females may be symptomatic if they are homozygous. Heterozygous women can manifest the disease if there is X chromosome inactivation, gene mosaicism or hemizygosity. At the genetic level, females have two alleles of the G6PD gene and therefore three genotypes are possible. First is the homozygous deficient, second is the heterozygous normal with one G6PD deficient and one normal allele, and third is the homozygous normal. Now, males only have one allele and so they can only be hemizygous deficient or hemizygous normal. Now, deficient homozygous female and hemizygous male will have a very low G6PD activity levels in their red blood cells, and therefore they will exhibit the deficiency phenotype in G6PD diagnostic test. Now, normal homozygous female and hemizygous male will exhibit a high or normal phenotype in G6PD diagnostic test. However, heterozygous female will exhibit intermediate enzyme activity in G6PD diagnostic test. Specific G6PD alleles are associated with G6PD variants with different enzyme level, thus different degree of clinical disease severity results. G6PDB+ is the normal enzyme in most population, while G6PDA+ is a normal variant in Americans of African descent. Now, G6PDB- variant is also known as G6PD Mediterranean. It is the most severe. In this variant, G6PD activity of homozygous female or hemizygous male is less than 5% of normal. Now, it occurs in high frequency in Italians, Greek, Mediterranean, Middle East African and Asian groups. G6PDA- variant occur in high frequency in Americans of African descent. Now, G6PD Canton variant occur in Chinese population. In this, the mutant enzyme has markedly reduced activity. G6PD activity is divided into five classes. Class 1 is the severe deficiency, less than 10% of the activity. Now, it presents as chronic non-spherocytic hemolytic anemia. Class 2 is also severe deficiency, which is less than 10% of the activity, but it presents as intermittent hemolysis. Class 3 is the mild deficiency, in which the activity is 10 to 16% of normal, and it presents as hemolysis only with stressors. Class 4 is the normal enzyme variant. In this, activity is 60 to 150%, and there is no clinical sick leave. And class 5 is the increased enzyme activity that is more than 150%, and it has also no clinical significance. Now I will explain the pathogenesis. G6PD gene mutation result in decreased G6PD production in the RBCs. So there is reduced glutathione production, and this leads to decreased ability of the RBC to resist oxidant stress. So oxidant exposure result in cross-linking of the globin chain and the precipitation of hemoglobin. Precipitated hemoglobin bind to and deform RBC membrane, and this precipitated hemoglobin form membrane-bound inclusion bodies, which are the Hinze bodies. And these Hinze bodies, they are removed by the macrophages of the spleen in a form of semicircular portion of the RBC and result in the formation of white cells. Now, RBC membrane deformities trigger hemolysis in the blood vessel as well as the spleen, and this results in intravascular as well as extravascular hemolysis. Now, the degree of hemolysis varies with the drug or food and the amount ingested and the severity of the enzyme deficiency in the patient. So hemolysis result in normocytic anemia, and the free hemoglobin bind with the heptoglobin, and these hemoglobin-heptoglobin complexes are removed by the reticuloendothelial system and result in decreased serum heptoglobin levels. Now bone marrow compensate for the hemolysis by increased RBC production and result in increased reticulocytes in the circulation. Free hemoglobin is broken down to unconjugated bilirubin, and this result in jaundice. And the excess free hemoglobin in the blood is infiltrated by the kidney and excreted and result in hemoglobinuria. And the free hemoglobin in the blood is the hemoglobinemia. Now in neonates, the inefficient bilirubin conjugation, especially in the premature, or if there is associated Gilbert syndrome, these two things also contribute to jaundice. Now I will discuss the clinical manifestation. Most patients are asymptomatic. Symptomatic patients present with neonatal jaundice. Conjunctivitis is a rare complication, but it can be fatal. Now jaundice in neonates usually appear within 24 hours after birth, sometimes at the same time as or slightly earlier than physiological jaundice, but later than in blood group albuminization. Now when a pregnant woman ingests oxidant drugs, they may be transmitted to her G6PD deficient fetus, and hemolytic anemia and jaundice may be apparent at birth. Now in older children, episodes of acute hemolytic anemia occur due to oxidant stress, which is induced by exposure to certain drugs or chemicals, infections, ketoacidosis or ingestion of fava beans or certain foods. Now most children are asymptomatic and they appear normal between the episodes. Hemolysis begins 24 to 72 hours after exposure to this oxidant stress, and the symptoms include anemia, jaundice, fatigue, shortness of breath, hypotension, tachycardia, confusion, or in severe cases, dark tea-colored urine and back pain. Now, acute hemolysis is self-limiting, resolving after 8 to 14 days due to compensatory production of young RBC which have high level of G6PD. Now, this G6PD deficiency can also present as chronic non-spherocytic hemolytic anemia, and this occur in severe deficiency. Now, it is a rare condition, and in this hemolytic process may worsen after ingestion of oxidant drugs or foods. Now I will discuss the complications. Conjunctivitis is a risk for infants with significant hyperbilirubinemia. Now episodes of acute hemolysis in the older children may be life-threatening and can lead to cardiovascular compromise or acute renal failure. Skin ulcers are an infrequent complication that may occur in patients with severe G6PD deficiency. Similarly, splenomegaly and cholelithiasis may be associated with chronic hemolysis. Now, G6PD deficiency appears to be a risk factor for the development of diabetes mellitus. Now, it is important to mention that G6PD confers partial protection against malaria, and it may have a protective effect on ischemic heart disease, cerebrovascular diseases, and colorectal carcinoma. Now I will discuss the diagnosis of G6PD deficiency. During an episode of acute hemolysis, hemoglobin is decreased, retic count is increased, lactate dehydrogenase level is also increased, indirect bilirubin is increased, serum heptoglobin is decreased, and there is free hemoglobin in the plasma, which is the hemoglobinemia. Now blood urea nitrogen and serum creatinine may be raised, and these occur in the case of severe hemolysis. Now urine show hemoglobinuria. Now, peripheral blood smear on routine staining reveal polychromasia and white cells or blister cells. With supravital stains, hinge bodies can be visualized. Now the cell containing these inclusion, they are seen only for first 3 to 4 days of illness because they are rapidly cleared from the blood. Now in G6PD deficiency, Coombe test should be done and it is negative, and this rule out other immune mediated anemias. Now abdominal ultrasound is also helpful for assessing splenomegaly and gallstone in a patient with severe chronic hemolysis. Now hinge bodies are also seen in patients with unstable form of hemoglobin such as hemoglobin of corn. Heat stability and heat denaturation and high performance liquid chromatography can be used to identify this unstable hemoglobin and therefore rule out G6PD deficiency. Here white cells and hinge bodies are seen in peripheral smear. Now I will discuss the specific test to diagnose G6PD deficiency in RBCs. First is the screening test, which include qualitative test, and these are 3 tests. First is the rapid fluorescence spot test, which is also known as Whittler test. It detects the generation of NADPH from NADP and test is positive for G6PD deficiency if the blood spot failed to fluorescence under ultraviolet light. Second is the methemoglobin reduction test, and third is the dimethylene blue decoloration test. Definitive test to diagnose G6PD deficiency is the quantitative test, which is the spectrophotometric analysis of G6PD activity. Now it is a standard quantitative test, and in this we use leukocyte depleted blood sample. Now diagnosis is confirmed by finding reduced level of G6PD in erythrocyte, which is below less than 10% of the normal. Now because this enzyme is present in increased quantities in reticulocyte, so this test should be performed at a time when retic count is normal or near normal, that is about after a few weeks of illness. However, diagnosis can be suspected when G6PD activity is within low normal range in the presence of high retic count. Spectrophotometric analysis may fail to detect G6PD deficiency in heterozygous female due to residual activity in G6PD sufficient cell. Cytochemical method and cytofluorometry is used to identify G6PD deficient cell as well as G6PD sufficient cells in these cases. Chromate inhibition test is also more sensitive than spectrophotometric in heterozygous female. Now, a number of point of care tests, which are the rapid diagnostic tests for determining G6PD deficiency, they have been developed. They have a potential role in malaria endemic area for permitting safe use of primaquine, which can provoke hemolysis in person with G6PD deficiency. These can be safely used in male, female and infants, and the kit is simple, cheap and easily available. Now the test can be done with the patient blood at the bedside and it gives result in 10 minutes. One can easily learn to use these in just few hours. Now most rapid diagnostic tests do not require cold chain. However, there is a drawback that it is not reliable in heterozygous female. This is the rapid diagnostic test kit. Now here are the steps to perform rapid diagnostic test. First, prick the patient finger with a lancet to get a drop of blood. Use pipette to collect this drop of blood. Now put the corrected volume of blood into a designated sample hole on the test strip. Then add 2 drops of buffer to a separate hole. Now wait for 10 minutes and determine G6PD enzyme status. Now if there is purple color, it indicates normal G6PD activity. This is because nitroblue tetrazolium embedded on the test strip is converted to formazin, which is purple. Now if there is no color or just white or faint color change, this indicates G6PD deficiency. Now friends, I will discuss the treatment. Important is the prevention, as you all know very well that prevention is better than cure. Now individuals with G6PD deficiency should avoid drugs, chemicals and foods that can cause oxidant stress, which can ultimately trigger hemolytic crisis. Now patients should keep the list of drugs and chemicals to be avoided all the time and wherever they go. They should wear a G6PD label locket or band, and they should spread awareness in the family and educate relatives about this illness. Now G6PD deficient patient should not donate blood. Now there is no pharmacological therapy or cure for G6PD deficiency. During an hemolytic episode, identification and discontinuation of the precipitating agent is critical. Anemia is treated with supportive therapy and blood transfusion is used only in severe hemolysis. Neonatal hyperbilirubinemia is treated with phototherapy or exchange transfusion, and prophylactic oral phenobarbital does not decrease the need for phototherapy or exchange transfusion. Now, heme analog like tin mesoporphyrin can inhibit bilirubin production, but this remains an experimental agent. For chronic non-spherocytic hemolytic anemia, folic acid in a dose of 1 mg per day is given. And splenectomy is ineffective in these cases. Thanks for watching this video. Please don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to my channel.